really celebrating the Christmas season, because today we conclude the octave of Christmas. Christmas is the highest feast of the church because it is the mystery. How God, who is in need of no one, and nothing would make him complete because he completed himself, he became one of us so that we can be like him, sons and daughters of the Father. And that mystery the church celebrated for 8 days. And as we conclude that octave today, we know that there is no birth without a mother. And so the vehicle by which God intend to bring this child in the world was by the blood and flesh of this beautiful woman that he created so beautiful for her office of maternity, which is the highest title we can give to Mary, the mother of God and Theotokos. And how this came about is because the church was under attack from two different people in the year 300, and also beginning of the 4th century. One was Arius from Alexandria, a priest who denied that Jesus was divine. Then there was Apollinaris who denied that Jesus was human. And the church gathered together under the intercession of those four patriarchs of the West. And we have to remember Athanasius, because the creed that you say with me a few moments from now is the Nicene Creed. You know why it's called the Nicene Creed? Because it was formed at the Council of Nicaea, 325. And there was Athanasius, St. Basil, St. Gregorius Nazianzus, beside by the way, tomorrow is their feast day. St. Basil and St. Gregorius Nazianzus. And also St. John Chrysostom must forget that one, because they were the instigation behind all this, that council will take place and define one forever that Jesus is the Son of Mary. But it takes 100 years down the road in 431, when the bishops come together again to identify that this Jesus was a person, and that person was divine from all eternity. In time he took flesh, and so he has one divine person, and that person is God named Jesus, the feast of today. So that's why the church celebrates this feast, because at every Christmas, at every birth, there has to be a mother. Also, the church celebrates today the feast of the holy name of Jesus. I mean, as I told you, many of you will think from days ahead before the birth to give a name to the baby. So Mary has no choice, together with Joseph. It was designed that this child would be called Jesus, Joshua, Savior. If you look at the first reading today, God spoke to Moses and said, you want me to bless your people? You want your people to have blessing? Invoke my name. I wish the whole parish is here to hear it. Many people want prosperous year, good year, all health. They want wealth. They want everything this year. They pray and they wish each other. But no wealth and no things comes from this creation but from God. You want me to bless you? You want my face shine upon you? Invoke my name. And to invoke God is not in vain, but to come to work. Observe the commandments. If you observe the commandments, I will bless you. If you don't want in your life, then it is your choice. And that is the first lesson we learn today, in the beginning of the year. We want God to bless us. We want God to be with us. We want God to give us his love. Just ask. Just be there. Just ask him. As Jesus said, ask and you shall receive it. Then we go into the gospel there. There is a lot of stories. The story of the nativity, there is a lot to hear. A lot to be taught about. This God, who is the creator creator of the only cosmos, the creator of the world. He chose to be born in a stable. And who are his visitors? The shepherd, the most poor of the poor. And they come there to worship. Because the angel told him, go to Bethlehem, and then you will find, and they come and they found Jesus. They found him in the manger. They found Mary and Joseph. They record to them. And Mary now, that kept all this secret in her heart, because Mary was in trouble. Mary was a single woman. Mary was going to have a baby. Her fiancé does not know about this. What she's going to do? The angel said to Mary, don't be afraid. Everything will take care. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. And the Son will be born with the name Jesus. And he will be the Son of the Eternal Father. He will reign like his father David forever. And that's why we saw Mary, when the angels were recalling what happened, she took it to her heart. And she was reflecting now. The mystery of the incarnation is out. God revealed it to the world. He is the Son of God. The angels from heaven come to adore him, that God made flesh. That God, that during the time of the first wage of war in heaven, was Lucifer, who said to God, "Non serve you. I will not serve you. I will not kneel in front of you as a human." And because of that, they left heaven together with all his companions. That was the fight of Michael. Who is my God? Who can tell God what to do? But he, after the sin of our forefathers, intends to come to be human. Then we also see how on the eighth day, when they come to circumcise the baby, they gave him the name, above every other name, the name Jesus, as he was proclaimed by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. What happened to us, dear people? I'm not talking about young people, I'm talking about all of us here. I don't see many young people here, about 3 or 4. What happened to us at the name of the Lord Jesus? We used to bow our heads. What happened? When you mention that name, it's not Joseph, the butcher, you know. It's God. It wasn't a Phoenician man, a Phoenician proclaimer. He is the Kyrios, he is the Lord. I go in the second reading today. And that second reading, St. Paul hit it on target. He was right on. He's writing to the people of Galatia. If you want to know St. Paul, read that letter. A little long, but there you see what St. Paul is all about, how much he really endured for the Lord. And today, as he began that letter, he said, in the fullness of time. So not once upon a time, like we read in the book of literature, but in the fullness, when God find it proper, when God prepared his people, he sent his son born of a woman. Many of you would be offended to that because you say St. Paul is ignorant. He's not mentioned the name of Mary. How come? Number one, remember, for God, it is not Mary. For God, she is the full of grace. Remember the salutation? They didn't say, "Hey Mary, how are you?" Ave gratia plena. Hail, full of grace. Hail, the one that God has prevented you from that day of your conception without sin. St. Paul knows how woman was not very well respected during this time. And that's why some people say that he was a chauvinist. Get that? Did you get that? He was not a chauvinist. Listen to me carefully. Remember what happened in the Genesis. What happened in Genesis? After our father and mother has sinned there in the Garden of Eden, sin entered the world. And after Eve blamed the serpent and Adam blamed the wife, or made the case, we see that God spoke to the serpent. And he said to him, you will be cursed. And she, that means the Blessed Virgin, she will put her foot on your head. You try to strike at her, but the fruit of her womb will destroy your power. That woman is the woman that Jesus spoke at the wedding of Cana. Remember, there was a wedding in Cana, and the apostles, because Jesus was invited, came to this wedding. They were fishermen. Thirsty. The wine is finished. The Blessed Mother said to him, do something. They are going to go in Paris. And Jesus said to her, woman, what's your concern of yours? Concern me. My hour is not yet. Mary ignored, and she said to the people serving, do what he tells you. We will come to that. What happened at the cross? Jesus was insulting his mother when he said, woman, behold your son. Because at that very moment, in the beginning of the ministry of Jesus, and at the end of the ministry of Jesus, Mary took on the job of Eve. Eve in the garden became the woman of sin. She brought sin into the world. And it was by the power of God that he selected Mary to bring forth the power of grace. One brought sin, one destroyed the power of sin because of her fruit. And that's why St. Paul speaks about that woman. Of course she knows who Mary was. It was 3 years after the resurrection that St. Paul became an apostle. He had an encounter with the apostles in Jerusalem. He's writing after that episode. He knows who Mary was, the mother of Jesus, but St. Paul is making a point. In the fullness of time, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Whenever there is an abuse, a law comes in. Is that true, lawyer? It's true. When there is an abuse of something, a law comes in. I try to sneak behind the corner to make out before the other car comes in, and so they put a sign there, stop! And the cops will be at the donuts there waiting for me to do that to give me a ticket. I deserve it. My dear people, that's why law comes in. Every law comes in because of abuse. That's why God gave the law to Moses. And what he said to him? Love me, respect me, give me my due. Do not. You know, that's the commandment. And do not because they were doing it. If they were not doing it, there is no need of law. And that's why St. Paul said we were born under the law because we went against the law. With this nature, we become fragile and we become sinful, and so our nature is sinful nature because it's attracted because of sin to evil things, to things that are not, as we say, so good, and to save us from them. And after he saved us from the power of sin, from death, the death everlasting I'm talking about, he gave us an adoption. And the adoption is to become children of God, to become sons and daughters of God. And if you were adopted, you have the right of inheritance, do you not? And that's what St. Paul said. And we, who become now children of God, and how we become children of God? Because Jesus himself, Father, told us that we are children of God. You remember what he said to us? It didn't say my father, it said our father. And when he rose from the dead, and Mary Magdalene was seeking where the body was, he appeared to her in the form of the gardener that she thought he was, and he said, go to my brother and tell him, I am going to my God and your God, to my father and your father. So Jesus now make us equal with him. We come daughters and sons of God. And if we are daughters and sons with Jesus, we are brothers with Jesus, then we are sons of God. That's why at the mixing of the water and wine, the priest said, bathed by this mystery of water and wine, he who share our nature, we share with him his divinity. Because we are called to be with him in heaven. Then St. Paul said, if we become now children of God, we have the right of heaven. If somebody adopts a child, that child has the right to inherit their estate. And what is the effort we inherit? We inherit the kingdom of heaven, because that's why Christ came, to destroy the power of sin, to open the gates of heaven, and to give to us who receive him and live by his message eternal salvation. How many of you say, well, this has to do with us? Number one, if we don't keep God number one in our lives, especially this coming season, we are going to be sorry. Because we are living in a world that God is me. Do you recall some of your children, they come to see you, not because they want to see you, but they are in need of some. You know what I mean? Mom, we are not making it. Can you lower some?
Lower us.
Yeah, lower my foot. Then you say, oh, mother, we don't have to give it to you. So sometimes they make themselves God. They make themselves, they look for God in money. They look for God's sports. There are people who allow coaches to do what they want with their lives. There are parents who do not know how to say, now listen, you can come for practice, you can have the games Sunday afternoon, or Sunday morning, or Saturday afternoon, you cannot. Oh, no. Because the parents are relive their own childhood, because they were losers when they were young, and so they have to fight with the coach, they have to fight with other parents, and the little leagues became the little fights in the event. You know how many times, you know, I said, no, I would not come to these, because what I see on takes place on those benches there is really pathetic. Let the child lose and win, that is a game. Why you have to get involved with the empires and with this and who fight with this one and end in a fun game to be, you know, the fight of the adults? But that's what our God is today. God is me, because me. There is no you in my life. God is money. God is sport. And our God remains outside. Then we want blessing. Remember what he said, invoke me. That means I am part of your life in order that I can bless you. Number two, the church presents Mary as the legion. Remember the legion of Mary, the legion, said Mother of the Legion, she had her gown open, her hand open. She's the general. We are walking behind her. And you know, the one with the horns exists. For some people, do not exist. For some people say, oh, wow, you are too harsh. You allow the enemy who is next to you. St. Peter said that Satan is like a lion roaring to see if he can get it. He will get us many times. He gets me, I don't know about you, Alan. But your thing is this, that the Blessed Mother said, try it. Try to take one of those behind me and they will tell you, I did you once and they will do it more. And they will smash your head. That's why the Blessed Mother is so powerful. He is so terrified of her. Because he cannot claim her to be his. He can claim me, he can claim you, because we have sinned. But he cannot claim her to be his own. And so the fight continues. That's why the Blessed Mother is the head of the year, to protect, to be the mother of the church, to be the mother who protects us always. And the third thing that we learn is that we have love for the Word of God. W-O-R-D. You remember what the Blessed Mother said in Nazareth? What she said in Nazareth? After the angel announced to her Elizabeth going to have a baby, what she said? Let it be done to me according to your word. The word of Nazareth become the word of Bethlehem, become the word of Calvary. Remember what we heard in the garden. We should reflect in her heart. Imagine how she felt that God has entrusted her with his great gift, the gift of his son. She has to be superb so that she would take the infant. And I always love the statue of Blessed Mother with the baby in her hands. Because she conceived him, she gave him birth, and now let him give to us. Imagine how she felt when she had that baby. The Word of God, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, according to the angel in her arms. Imagine how she felt when he began to walk, when she read to him the Torah, when she gave him the Torah to read. Imagine how she coached him not to fall. Imagine how she felt when she saw him with Joseph, working and doing all kinds of things. Imagine how she disciplined him. Remember when she was lost? My son, your father and I have been trying to find you. Where have you been? You don't know that I have to be in my father's business? And scripture said, and he was obedient to her. And he came to Nazareth, and he was subject to her. Imagine. Mary have authority on God. Imagine how she felt. That beautiful vocation that a mother has. Do we not say, oh, when we see somebody who is very well liked by his mother or the mother are very well fond of him, oh, he is the baby, the mother's baby. And we are not saying something like that, because it's the truth. Not because they carry us in 9 months, but because their singular vocation of the mother. That there is intimacy between the child and the mother. We cannot take it away. And let me tell you, I was a pastor of a church which had a school, the liberal school. I can take 500 children together. I can. We have mass, we have this, and I can control them. My sister Celia, the principal, used to come, Father, we have problems, but what's new? There are two parents that want to come to talk to you because they don't want to listen to me. All right. And you sit there. And I said, do you want to talk in front of the principal or now with the principal? And then the principal said, well, you know, your son was in the class. And he was writing love notes to try to flip them to go to the other girl on the other side. And told the teacher that now they are 8th grade, they don't need to learn anymore, so that you have no lesson. And your teacher was intimidated by them, and your son needs to be punished. Oh, not my Joey! What's wrong with you? You hate my boy. Even you, principal, you said with him, you hate my boy? It's like we are ordained, that we are put in the convent or going to school to hate children. Give me a gun, Lord, will you? So this is what's going on. Mother, never, 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 never put their children down. They always support them, even in their mistakes. Do you think that she will do anything to us to put us down? Never. She took the oath from Calvary that we are now her children. But dear people, the last lesson we learn is not only to have great devotion to her, but to have have great estimation for the work of God. If I ask you, don't embarrass yourself. If I ask you privately, how many of you read the scripture of today? Read it, the dreams. How many of you prayed over them? How many of you raised your hand and said a prayer for me so I can be inspired by the Holy Spirit to give me the word? That's what we do on Monday night here. We read the scriptures. You tell me what you read. Within the tree, we find a common factor that unites them together. See what God spoke to you, because it's not the sermon that's more important, it's the word. That's why lectors, deacons, priests, be careful to pronounce the word of God. Because that is the power, as we call it, the power engine of the entire liturgy, the word of God. That you read it, you read it, you read it, and you have three different thoughts and three different messages. Imagine, at the room there, everyone is different. One of the things that I have to say to you, the people of this parish, I was in different parishes. I always have 20 and more people for a scripture. Here is just 6, 7. That means the word of God means nothing to him. And that's why we have problems. Do you think the problems are going to cease? No. But if you do not invade yourself in the scripture, if you don't become familiar with the scripture, you don't know Jesus. Not my word, take your arms at that. In the Holy Scripture you have the message. And the message will soften your problems. Will give you guidance how to proceed. And to open your heart for the Holy Spirit to guide you. That's Holy Scripture. So, naive of Scripture, naive of Jesus, and you are going to have a disaster in your life, in your spiritual life. Read the Scripture before you come to Mass. Maybe Friday night, Saturday night, whatever it is, read it. Pray over it. Let it come. Speak to you. Put yourself there. This is what our Holy Father, Benedict XVI, is trying to say to us in Divina Lectionis. But we have to think about the Word of God. We have to relive the Word of God. Let God talk to us. And then when you leave church, you don't say, oh, he talks for half an hour. Oh, I don't know what he said. Oh, it's so boring. Of course it's boring. If you do not put yourself in liturgy, if you don't invest in what we are doing right now, by sitting there being a spectator, you're going to go home empty and angry because I said something that hit the nerve. I received emails. I do not like to come to your Mass because you tell us things that sometimes upset me, because in the past I lived those things. I do not like it because I don't want to go home like that. What do you think I am here to talk about Shakespeare? I talk about the gospel. And if the world was in so good frame of time, of mind, why did Jesus ever talk to come to us? And what was his words to you and to me? Repent! And believe in the good news. So to repent means you are doing something you are not supposed to do. And believe in the word of God. I leave you with that, people. You want your problems to cease? You want God to bless you? Take that book and make it your own. Et verbum caro factum es, et tabit habet in nobis. And the word of God becomes flesh and dwell among us. So to know the scripture is to know Jesus. And Jesus is the way to the Father. Simple. You want to have peace? Make God at the center of your life. Speak about God with whom you meet. Be familiar with the Holy Scriptures. Because St. Paul said, the word of God, and I conclude with this, is to equip us, to correct, would know that God is inviting you to love you, and you in return need to love him. Have great respect for the word of God. Maybe this is the promise you make for this new year, to be familiar with the word of God, so that you'll be familiar with Jesus. And the closer you come to him, the more you will have blessing. God bless you. Let us now stand and profess our holy faith. Please take the cards in your hand, because the word